Good morning. This is Pastor John Bales, pastor of Twinbrook Community Church in Rockville, Maryland. Welcome to this presentation. This morning we are going to continue in our pattern together of worship, communion, and the Word. I'd like to read, as we open this morning, a call to worship from the Psalms. Your love, Lord, reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness to the skies. Your righteousness is like the highest mountains. Your justice like the great deep. You, Lord, preserve both people and animals. How priceless is your unfailing love, O God. People take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house. You give them drink from your river of delights. For with you is the fountain of light, life. In your light, we see light. Continue your love to those who know you, your righteousness to the upright in heart. Praise the Lord. Let's prepare ourselves for worship. Father, I thank you for your goodness. I thank you for your mercy and for your kindness. I thank you, Lord, that your goodness does reach to the heavens. And we thank you, Lord, that you have reached so tenderly toward us and drawn us into a place of refuge, a place of salvation. In Christ Jesus, as he has atoned for our sins at the cross. Our sins are buried from you as far as the east is from the west. They're buried in the sea of your forgetfulness, you say in the word. And Lord, we rejoice in that today. Rejoice in that today, Lord, that you have saved us and drawn us into your kingdom. For your goodness and your glory. We love you. We turn our hearts now to you and ask for you to give us peace. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you as you love and serve the Savior this week.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who can ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder, show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken, and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken, and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
From the earth to the cross, my death.
came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross, my death to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on
you are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. For you are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. For you are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You deserve the glory and the honor. Lord, we lift our hands in worship and we praise your holy name. You deserve the glory and the honor. Lord, we lift our hands in worship and we praise your holy name. For you are great, you do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. For you are great, you do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you.
Today, I wanted us to focus upon the celebration aspect of the Lord's Supper. We realize, of course, that the Passover was foundational for the Lord's Supper. And the Passover meal was a meal of celebration. There were four cups of wine that were drunk during the Passover meal. The third cup, which immediately followed the meal, was a cup of thanksgiving, a cup of celebration. And when the Lord in offering the Lord's meal to the disciples, took the cup after supper, it is perhaps a reference to that cup taken immediately after supper. Well, why is it a meal of celebration for us? Well, it's a meal of celebration because on the basis of Christ's sacrifice for us, he meets together with us in this meal. When the Lord instituted the Lord's Supper in the upper room, he was together there with the disciples. At the consummation of all things, he will be with us there in the celebration of that meal. In between, we have the Lord's Supper that we celebrate here and now. And in that celebration, the Lord promises and declares that he will be with us spiritually by faith in the celebration of this supper. And so we celebrate today by faith that Christ is spiritually present with us. We are communing with him. And in this communing with him, we are looking forward to that great day when we will be celebrating the marriage supper feast of the Lamb, where Christ is enthroned over the new heavens and the new earth, and his glory is seen in the realm of the new heavens and new earth like beyond our imagination, beyond our comprehension. We will be sharers and delight in the glory of Christ. What an exciting and thrilling thing it is to know that we are united together with him by faith, and in the celebration of this supper, that is a declaration of our union with him and that he is spiritually present with us now. May you be encouraged by this reality in your faith today. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful today for your presence in our lives and for the promise that you are spiritually present with us here in the celebration of this meal by faith. And so, Lord, I pray that you might encourage the heart of everyone that is watching this today, that is celebrating this Lord's Supper with us, that they might be encouraged in their faith and your presence in their lives and your presence in the context of this supper. The Lord tells us that in his word, that on the night that the Lord was betrayed, he took bread. And after he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." Let us take together. And in celebrating this meal, the sacrifice of Christ upon the cross, giving himself in perfect obedience for us, and his imputed righteousness, his blood that was shed for the forgiveness of our sins, we now also take the cup. And after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us take together. For as often as we eat the bread and drink the cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he returns. God bless you.
We're looking today at the fourth chapter of the Gospel of Mark, and we're going to look at verse 30 through 34 together. Would you stand with me one more time as we honor God's word and read together? Again he said, "What shall we say the kingdom of God is like? Or what parable shall we use to describe it? It is like a mustard seed, which is the smallest of all seeds on earth. Yet when planted, it grows and becomes the largest of all garden plants, with such big branches that the birds can perch in its shade." With many similar parables, Jesus spoke the word to them, as much as they could understand. He did not say anything to them without using a parable. But when he was alone with his disciples, he explained everything. Father, I pray that you will teach us your word today. Not by might, not by power, but by your Spirit. We thank you, Father, that Jesus has sent us another comforter, who is not going to speak about himself, Jesus said. He's going to speak about the Lord himself, and he's going to lead us into truth. In the same way, we hear the words of this comforter, Jesus Christ, as he spoke the word, and it led these men, women, even children who heard it, it led them to truth. I pray in the same way, Father, we will first rejoice that we have been included in that number, and secondly, that we are also in the presence of a teacher, the Spirit himself leading us today. So we all, both speaker and hearer, ask for you to illuminate us by his presence. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord. Well, we come to the last of these kingdom parables that Jesus is speaking, has spoken, starting in the verse 1 of chapter 4. And we've also seen how all four of these are linked together. That really it's a one long parable with four verses, really, the way that Mark has organized it and shared it. We see Mark's influence here, Mark's organization, as he even says that there are many parables that all speak about the Word of God. And so he has taken these four parables, and we know that these four parables are ones that Mark is using, because when you look at the parallel passages in Matthew and Luke, you see the same parable parable of sower, and it's linked to the parable of the yeast in the dough. So in that way, Mark and Matthew use that to reach an audience with the same message, but yet use different of the parables to do it. And so we see somewhat of a collection of parables that are available at this time to these gospel writers, and they take from this collection of parables that, first of all, were in a general verbal format, as the gospel is transmitted verbally from person to person by the preachers, the disciples first, the apostles that followed, and then finally Christian after Christian after Christian. And we see the oral tradition that was very powerful is now being put down into written form. Mark was the first of the four gospel writers to put the gospel into written form. And he has crafted it to do some specific things for his audience, and we have discovered that Mark's audience was Rome. He wrote this from Rome. He wrote it shortly after Peter's death in Rome. Peter was his apostolic connection, and as a result, we see him shaping the message of the gospel, the good news, the glad tidings of the Lord, into a message that will reach an audience in their particular situation. Now, we know under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit that all of Scripture does this now. All of Scripture, as we read all of Scripture, we have this huge benefit now. We don't just have Mark's gospel, we have all the gospels, we have all the New Testament, we have all the Old Testament. And as a result, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is good for it's profitable for teaching and correction, instruction, and righteousness, as we see in the epistles. But in this first use of Mark, this first time as Mark is writing down these parables, he's organizing this to reach a persecuted group of people in Rome, Christians in Rome, under the beginning of the horror of Nero's persecution of Christians in Rome. And a good place to be when persecution starts is hiding someplace, saying nothing. But he is saying to them, no matter what kind of context you're in, he takes this parable of Jesus and shows whatever context you're in, whether it's a hard context, whether it's a rocky context, whether it's a thorny context, or whether it's just a perfect situation, whatever the context, sow the seed. Don't think that you're there to protect yourself and elongate your life and try to, you know, have a prosperity or something like that. That's not why we're here. We're here to be sowers of the seed. The same way that we've been recipients of that sown seed by someone else. And, you know, looking around, and we look at our own audience today. I mean, before we were Christians, what kind of soil were we? Were we just this great soil waiting for the gospel to be sown into us? Is that what you remember being? Or maybe we could describe ourselves in one of the other three soils more accurately. But Jesus' words are so alive and active. And as a result, we see Mark putting these particular parables in sequence in order to bring out a very particular message. And he examines the entire scope of the kingdom of God and how it advances. How does the kingdom of God advance? Well, if you were going to say, how do you take a simple message and craft it in such a way that it will last for 2,000 years? Just a single message, and it will continue to have a massive impact on everyone who hears it. How do you craft a message like that? It's a pretty big challenge. And how then do you ensure that it continues to be spoken? And how then do you have a right perspective on what's really happening in your message? And what do you think your role is in the continuation of that message? All these things are things that he has woven together in order to encourage, not a church in America. Of course, it is an encouragement to us as we finally become the recipients ourselves. But to think of a person who is under intense persecution, wondering, am I going to survive this? Are my children going to survive this? It's one thing if I am hurt and I am killed, but to have to watch my children be killed or persecuted, surely that's worth hiding this light under a bushel and not broadcasting it. Or thinking in terms of maybe I don't need to be the one to do this. And I should hold the seed back because it seems to be so offensive. And so you can see as Mark is, he's not slapping people around. He's simply saying, this is who we are. This is what we've been called to do. We're redeemed to do this. And if this is true in the context of the persecution that we see in the Roman period, as Mark is writing this, surely it is applicable today for us. So as a result, we see these same kinds of introspections as we look at it. He's using a botanical metaphor. A lot of them. But this message is clearly a spiritual application. I hope that we get that. We need not pursue the words in any of these four parables as if to say, is this really accurate what he's saying? Is it really accurate when he talks about these things? Are these soil types really accurate? And get ourselves lost in the parable itself, but not recognize the parable is a metaphor pointing to something else. And I've seen these kinds of analysis where you get somebody that gets lost in the idea of what these soils are, how they were created. And we did a little bit of that. Jesus, when he gave the parable, he didn't say a single thing about the application. He just talked about a farmer sowing seed and where the seed goes and what happens to the seed when it gets there. Is that all it really was being spoken about? These four parables. The question is Jesus really omniscient? Is he really all-knowing? If he's God, then why doesn't he know that there are seeds smaller than a mustard seed in the world? Or that his calculations on the aeration of soil are off? Or that, and on and on and on it goes. We realize we lose the entire point because we want to argue over the types of soil, or we want to argue over the size of a mustard seed. And we find ourselves then finally really in the place where Satan is trying to get us the whole time, and that is to just lose the message altogether. What did you get out of the sermon today? Well, you know, the pastor was arguing for the type of soil is this, that, and the other thing. And that made a mustard seed is really not the smallest seed in the whole world. And blah, 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 blah. Really, is that what Jesus was talking about? Is he coming to give farmers, or all farmers there? It's like going to a farmer's conference, right? Come down to the sea, farmers. I want to give you a little conference on how you plant your seeds. You think that's really what's going on here? You think when he called Peter and Andrew and James and John from the fishing boats that he said, guys, you stick with me, and I'm going to show you how to make some lures and how to have your net made in a certain way, in a certain depth, in a certain diameter, and the weight you throw nets out, man, I'm going to teach you guys how to really fish. You think that's what he was doing? You know, you think when Paul says he was a mender of nets, that means he was also a fisherman. He also knew these, I mean, sometimes we should say, give it a rest. Don't spend any time on the metaphor. Spend all of our time on what the metaphor teaches us about ourselves. I can almost hear you saying it in your mind. Amen. Move on. Amen. We see in these parables, first parable, the parable sower. It highlights that our ministry is to share the gospel, to sow the seed of the glad tidings in whatever soil, whatever type of life we encounter. It is the key to our ministry to share the gospel. Now, I like to avoid jokes, but one comes to mind right now of the dog food company that decided they were going to have a new dog food. This is an old joke, so maybe you're not even heard it because it's so old. Maybe I shouldn't tell a joke. But anyway, they're all sitting around a conference table, and Promise me you won't just remember the joke today, okay? This is a joke that points to something else, all right? But there they are. They're all sitting around the table, and they're talking about the nutritional value and how wonderful the nutritional value is and the color, and, you know, it comes from vegetables and all these kind of things, and on and on and on and on and on. But finally get to the to their accountant, and he says, but in the first quarter, it's the sales are way down. Well, it can't be, because, and they just keep analyzing the dog food itself. And finally, this old guy that's been with the company for 100 years, he raises his hand. And they say, okay, Ralph, what is it? He says, the dogs don't like it. That's what's wrong with it. You know, it's simple truth. If you think you're a sower in the kingdom of God, then don't busy yourself with what the types of soil are, all these other things that we come to in relationship to what the parable is showing. Sow the seed. Well, I think that's my ministry, really. Well, sow the seed. Don't analyze what your ministry is. Sow the seed. It's like air. Are you breathing the right quality of air right now? Maybe we should think about the air in this room and really get ourselves lost on the... Breathe! Breathe the air. Breathe the air. Sow the seed. It should be as simple and as forthright as that, almost to the point you think, why is he reminding us of this? Because there's going to be things that he designed, that he outlines in the parable of sower. There's going to be these circumstances that make we think we shouldn't or won't sow seed in a certain way. I mean, we're going to sow seed in this room today. Should I really think I should sow seed on a carpet? Do you think that's what he's talking about? Should I really share the gospel with my own family? I mean, haven't they heard it already? Should I really sow the gospel with my next door neighbors? I mean, isn't that kind of their private place and I should stay away from them? Shouldn't I really just get all these things and find a rationale for why we don't do it? Sow the seed. I've only got this one person that is not a Christian that I know of. Sow the seed. Sow the seed. In the second verse, he talks about a lamp and a stand. And it's again an exhortation to sow the seed. It is inconceivable that anyone who has been touched by the light of the gospel and filled with that light could or would then seek to hide its rays from someone else. Personal. Religion is personal. I don't want to invade someone's space. I don't want to overstep my grounds. You know, those are things we say inside of ourselves before they're even applicable. They're preconditions that we often place within ourselves because we're already not going to do it. Because we're afraid. Because we may think that we're going to have some kind of reaction toward us. Because they're going to not like us anymore. Or they're going to turn us in to somebody, to the religious police. It says, let your light shine. Don't hide something as natural as the message of what has happened in your life from someone else, especially when they're actually asking you what has happened to you. Just last week, we were out for a little ride and with Candace and David and the little baby, and we drove up Tuckerman Lane underneath 270. You ever drive up there? And I said, it was right there where someone first asked me, what happened to you? He literally, driving down Tuckerman Lane, on where we're going, driving down Tuckerman Lane, and suddenly it was a rainstorm. He just pulled over under this bridge and stopped and turned and says, what happened to you? I said, what do you mean? He said, you haven't cussed for at least 10 minutes. What happened to you? And I can't tell you the number of thousands of times someone has said to me, what happened? Or some question where you simply just are responding to the light that is within you. Just the light. Why do you think that? Where did you come from? What are your parents like? What has your life been like? Where did you grow up? Where did you go to school? Just inundated with question after question after question. In fact, you know, in these, what's the thing that they learned in the church up in Philadelphia, or wherever, New York City, the Marble Collegiate Church, Norm Vincent Peale. How do you carry on a conversation? You should ask questions. Good. Bring them. Especially, as Peter said, be ready to answer a question regarding what? The light that is in you. The light. Do you have light in you? That worship service was fantastic today. You know, I was just overwhelmed by the words as they came forth. You know, the idea of what God has done for us. What a powerful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. We hear it all the time. You hear Jesus' name all the time. You hear it in a blasphemous way, and you hear people crying out to Jesus. You hear people say, oh my God. And you think, yes, oh my God. I would like to echo any person who says, oh my God. Says, yes, oh my God. Praise the Lord. You'd say it a lot, wouldn't you? Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Third verse, the parable of the growing seed. It brings us to the marvel. The marvel at the power of God in regeneration. Bringing something to life that's dead and hidden in darkness. The seed, it says, is planted, and it's planted in the soil, in the darkness. Yet there's air there. Yet there's water there. But that doesn't make it grow. He says, the farmer doesn't know why it grows. He doesn't know why the seed comes to life. It appears to be a dead piece of material. But you sow it into the ground, under the ground, in the depth of the soil. And something happens. And it spontaneously regenerates all by itself, it says. That's Mark's high statement of the knowledge of what happens. It happens all by itself. Now, it hasn't changed much. As we just examined last time, people, scientific minds come to the high and lofty place of saying that they need something to happen in order for their scientific perspective to work. And just simple things. Something has to come from nothing. That's all. Something has to come from nothing. How does it happen? And here, these scientific minds who have just laid bare all of your, Christian views, they say, it just happens. It just happens. What about the scientific method? It said nothing happens unless it's acted upon by a force of some kind of equal power, equal or greater power. Well, let's tell you, that's down the line. That's later. Oh, really? Your something has to have something that acts on it. And it turns us to the revelation of Scripture. Well, you can go to any other religious book you want. Go to any other religious book you want and ask that question. And then it comes up blank. Ask the scientific method. What is it? Oh, well, you know, you just have this blind faith. It's just blind faith. Well, you have blind faith, so we have blind faith. No, I don't. Bible says that God is all-powerful, and He is self-existent eternally. I am that I am. I have my life within myself. And Jesus said that life is the life and light of men. It didn't just happen. Seeds don't just, something happens. Yes, something does happen. But it's God directly exerting His power and His person upon that. And He puts us in our proper perspective. Can you make that happen? Is that your message, that I'm going to preach, I'm going to put the seed down, and I'm going to make it come up? No. There's no evidence in Scripture that we can do anything to get anybody saved. Even in the statement of reconciliation, about how we're ambassadors for Christ and we're calling people, we reconcile with God. We can't bring life into them. We can't make them dead from their transgressions and sins, or make them alive from their transgressions and sins. We can't do anything. Since now and last week, did you figure a way out? You can? No. But God brings those seeds that we plant, and some are planted in very hard places. We've witnessed to people that just you think you're wasting your time. I remember a fellow that I witnessed to when I was in junior college at Montgomery College in Rockville. He was a great tenor voice. He was a womanizer. He used to talk about all the women he had. He was a bouncer at some club down in D.C., and he used it to pick up women. And he, for some reason, loved me. And he really loves my wife. He would say, people would say things, he says, he's married to a very beautiful woman, very wonderful woman. And I come home and say, Karen, this guy really thinks you're great. Well, this guy, I said, but I wouldn't leave him alone with her for 5 seconds. Not because of her, of course, because of this lech. So we both sang in operas together at University of Maryland, and he went one way and I went the other way. And I'm coming back from someplace. I'm in Frederick. I know some of you heard this story at least 50 times probably. But here we are coming into Frederick, and there's this giant up there on Route 40. We're pulling down in the shopping center. It's like 12:30 at night because we're getting home late from some trip. And so I went into the store, and we bought our stuff, and we were getting in our car, and all of a sudden I hear this voice says, John Bales, praise the Lord! I'm going, whoa. I give up. It's me. I'm sorry. He comes up and he starts, he's wearing just a pair of, of coveralls, sleeveless things. The guy was very muscular. And just, I don't think he had any shoes on. I'm sure he had other clothes underneath, but, he didn't have, he looked like he was just half dressed. He comes up, gets about this close to my face, and he says, it's because of you that I'm a Christian. I'm just so happy. Jesus is my Lord. My marriage is fixed. Literally, I got kids. Look at all these kids. They're all my kids. He's relating this back to our conversations. I'm thinking, well, I didn't do anything. What did I do? Just throw a little seed. Just throw a little seed. First comes the stem, then comes the stalk, then the whole barley, and it starts crying out. Light starts shining through this dark, hardened soil. It's an incredible thing. He doesn't say, make it grow. He doesn't say, even understand how it grows. He says, sow it. All by itself, automatically. By the power of God alone, it germinates, comes alive, and begins to grow. It is God's work. He calls us to participate with Him, but it is God's work. And the parable teaches us how the gospel grows in the hearts of believers. It's not talking about seeds. Grows. In this last verse, this parable of mustard seed, then shows us the capacity of the seed and how it grows. That's what brings us to our text this morning. Verse 30, again, he said. Again. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice. Rejoice, therefore. isn't it amazing? All you got to do, just say it once. I got it. Just say it once. I'm kind of like my relationship in my house. Don't forget your wallet. I got it. That's just sits in my room before I even get out of my room, okay? Then as I come back by, don't forget your wallet. Okay, quit bugging me. What do you think, I'm a 3-year-old? And I'm right almost to the light at Wayne Garden and Whiskateria, and I go, oh my gosh, I forgot my wallet. That's just me, right, guys? Just me. It's just me. It's just me. Well, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say, rejoice. Rejoice, therefore. Stand. Stand in your relationship to Christ, it says in the armor passage. Stand in the power of God. Stand, therefore. Stand. And when you do, whatever you do, stand. It says it four times in about five or six verses. Stand, 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 stand. Now he's saying, ready? What's he saying? What's he saying? He's saying so in this particular text. He's saying so. Not so? No, sow the seed. Sow the seed. Sow the seed. But I can't. Yes, you can. It's true, you can't make the seed grow, but you can sure throw it. And let me tell you something. It's the key to sales. You can make more money in sales than any other job in the world. It's the highest paid jobs in the whole world are salespeople. But yet they get told no more than anybody else. And the person that keeps selling is a person that will eventually, or pitching is a person that eventually will sell. Same thing with seeds. It's not a one-on-one relationship with seeds. You can throw seeds out, and you might have 20% growth. You might have 30%. You might have 60%. You might have 100% growth. Isn't that what Jesus said? But that's not. It's just keep on throwing it. Keep on throwing the seed. What shall we say the kingdom of God is like? Or what parable shall we use to describe it? This really is Jesus' words, of course. But Mark is picking up on these words to say that all these parables that Jesus spoke, they have so many applications to so many things. You've seen this yourself, haven't you? You're talking to somebody and you think of one of the parables and what the lesson is in that parable. And in some other situation, you're talking to somebody about something completely different, and it's even the subject's different. You remember that same parable and how it applies here too. And so the more parables that were available, the more they felt there was a way to organize these things so they continued to have a message. And this is the message that he's giving. And he said, it's like a mustard seed, which is the smallest of seeds on earth. Now, what are we not going to do? I've already given this to you in the introduction. We're not going to focus on the earth and the size of a seed. They certainly talk about the size of the seed and what the seed can grow into, but he's not talking about seeds. He's not saying, here, you need to get a really good seed because this seed will really grow. No. He's talking about in our ministries. Say it's my ministry. Can you say it right now? My ministry. Okay. So we know it's about your ministry. So in this particular symposium, we're talking about your ministry and how your ministry can be even more fruitful. My ministry can be even more fruitful. It's like a mustard seed, which is the smallest of all seeds on earth. Yet when planted, it grows and becomes the largest of all garden plants, with such big branches that the birds can perch in the shade. Now there's a simple message here, and then there's a complex message here. The simple message is there's this tiny seed, mustard seed. Now you know my study Bible right here. You have a study Bible with pictures in it? You can see a guy, he's got his hand like this, and he's got his seeds on his hand, and he's holding up one little tiny seed, and it's one of the mustard seeds in that. And there's three types of mustard seeds, as we all know, and this is one of them. It's not microscopic like some people say, but it's very, very small. And you take that one small seed, and that one small seed, as it's planted in the ground, grows up so big that it looks like a tree. It literally has the size of a tree. And the change that takes place from that very small beginning to the ending is incredible. Now we can look at this as just the plant. It's incredible. How does that happen? How does it happen that such a small thing can produce something so big? Well, that's one of the things that's incredible about it. Secondly, it's also called what's called an annual plant, or biannual, which means that every year you plant a seed, it comes up as a plant. Sometimes it takes two cycles to have the lifestyle of that plant. But it's between one and two seasons that plant is planted and comes up, and then it dies off completely, becomes part of the soil. You have to plant another seed, and then that seed produces a plant the next year. So every year it has to be planted, and every year it will come up. And so the idea that it's really a preennial, which means that you plant it once, it grows up, and then it comes up over and over and over and over and over and over again until, you know, it dies. The kingdom of God is not like a perennial. It's not like Jesus started it, and then it just keeps happening all by itself. All by itself, this stuff happens. And so there's no other thing other than just, it says it happens all by itself, but that's the life that comes into it. But it takes sowing over and over and over and over and over again in every season of every year and every century, all the way till someone sowed it in you. Remarkable, isn't it? And at first, it's just marvelous. We get saved, it's just marvelous. Oh, something's happened to me. It's wonderful. I don't know what happened to me, but something happened to me. We might as well be the seed ourselves, right? I mean, what was your testimony when you got saved? Well, I know by the omnipotent power of God that He regenerated my heart by the Holy Spirit, even when just in that instantaneous moment I was regenerated by the Holy Spirit, which means life came into me and I came from death to life spiritually. And now, is that how you describe it? No. Man, something happened. Yet, over time, you become more and more understanding of what happened to you. That's why we have teaching from the Scriptures. That's why we have other parables, other applications of the word, so become more and more knowledgeable of the faith. Even when Paul says to the Philippians, I pray that you will grow even more in your knowledge of God. Don't think I've come to the apex of what I know about God, what I know about Christianity, what I know about the faith. We're never at that apex. We're only always just growing still. And there's immensities beyond what we know. So even mature Christians, in fact, very mature Christians, dedicated Christians, still desire to know more and more about God. It's such a thrilling thing to be reading the Scriptures or studying the Scriptures, and you see something you never saw before. As we do this together, one of the common comments that I have is, I never knew that. I've read it over and over, but I never knew that. Well, don't give me credit. It's the Word being germinated in our heart more and more and more and more, so we understand the heights and the depths and the breadth and the width of God. It's glorious, isn't it? And we become the sowers in that process, that we have to continually think of ourselves as starting over, starting over, starting over. I've shared the gospel with that person 100 times. But today's a new day. This is the day of salvation. When someone gets saved, they don't say, oh man, I heard that so many times. No, that day I heard it. That day it awakened me. That day. The day I believed. That day. I'm so glad I didn't get he's saved. Little sticker I wear, you tattoo it around your ear, whatever you do. He's saved. He's saved. He doesn't need the gospel anymore. He's saved. That was kind of how I was tagged. You know, those Bales boys are really little demons, but man, they're all saved at least. It was really kind of a bad rep. Especially my older brother, my younger brothers. I was, the middle guy's always the worst, right? So, I'm glad someone would say, well, we don't really need to worry about you knowing the gospel because you know the gospel. Because it wasn't until I was 23 years old, I'm sitting in this large building and there's a guy up there preaching, and suddenly I believed. I was awakened through new birth. I didn't have a tag that said, you don't need to be sown seed for you. I didn't go through the line that said, you come into this part of the service because we're going to talk about the gospel. The rest of you go over there because you already got the gospel. You never know. You never know what the seed is going to do when it's sown. You never know what your words are going to say. It may be the halt, you know, the frightened, halting statement that Jesus died for our sins. I'm so glad that Jesus has saved me and died for my sins. That's all you say. And yet, it's a seed that goes into that soil. And it grows. As we talked about Charles Haddon Spurgeon being this nobody kid that gets saved in a snowstorm as the replacement deacon because the pastor couldn't be there, is preaching, and it's on an off night. He's sitting in the back in the shadows. This is his testimony. Other people have other testimonies about it, or statements about what happened. But yet in that one moment, as he wasn't even preaching out of the New Testament, it was in the Old Testament. Repent! Repent! And this guy, he's got four people, the most committed people in the church, have been there every week, they sit on the front row, and he is wailing on these people, giving them the gospel. He may not even know this kid is in the back of the room, and yet this kid became one who grew like a largest tree in the kingdom, broadcast the message to millions and millions of people, came to faith in Christ through his message. You don't know who you're talking to. Billy Graham didn't get saved by the most important Christian on earth. Great persons that have become Christians, not the greatest person on earth was the one that saved them. It was usually some mother or father or friend, some nobody that no one ever remembers, except perhaps that person. Becomes the largest of all the trees in the garden. And its branches, even birds nest in its branches. Where do birds typically nest? Do they nest in plants? Well, why would a bird not nest in a plant? Because it's not going to last very long. You know, birds need to have some time to be in that bird house. I'm sorry, George, what did you say? It's too low to the ground, right? Not safe. But also, it doesn't last very long. So where do birds usually make their nests? Up in the top of a tree, well, like right up here. They make it right up there, and they tell us that they have their little babies. I want to show them off every spring to us. All that noise, and then they fly away, and now it's quiet again, right? But think of it. Why would the bird make a nest in a mustard plant? Because it's a very deceptive plant. I mean, you look online. I did this. I looked online. Mustard. Show me mustard plants. Some of them look like trees. They're big. They have a trunk-like bottom. They're big. It appears that there's a safe place to be because it's so established. It's large. Birds, it can even give bird confidence that you could have a nest here and it would last, it would be here. Little they know that as soon as those cold winds come and everything starts to shrivel, that great big plant's going to go down to nothing and it's not even going to be there next year unless, what? Someone sows the seeds again. Some things rise up, we put our trust in them. Large, this will be... We'll have this particular circumstance the rest of my life. I remember with my kids thinking, this is wonderful. Four little kids. My life is great. I love being with my family, these kids around the dinner table. This is never going to end. And one day it kind of hit me. One day, you're going to be looking back on this. I thought, well, yeah. Hey, guess what day it is? It's that day. They're wonderful, right? One day they're going to be going out and they're not going to say, can I come live with you still? We hope they don't stay that long. This is not talking about a process of security so we can always have the same things forever. The only thing that we have to have our trust and our security is we got to throw the seed. Does this sound redundant? Should I replace it with another word? Evangelize. Sow the seed. I think we get the point, don't we? I think it's kind of starting to scratch its way through. Verse 33, with many similar parables, Jesus spoke the word to them as much as they could understand. With many similar parables. This is saying if we were to say, let's teach the parables, and you might think, that would really be a great study, wouldn't it? The parables. You ever read a book called The Parables of Jesus? There are lots of them out. I took a course just recently on the kingdom of God. And one of the most highly used genres of teaching is parables, Jesus' teaching. And so there's this one book, and it's about close to 250 pages on parables. And you know, as you start reading that, you read the first one, you think, boy, that's just amazing. And then you read the second one, that's amazing. And the third one, it's a lot like the first one. And then the fourth, that's a lot like the second. For long, you know, the whole genre is boiled down to about, you know, three different messages. And they're pretty simple. And Mark, we think, well, Mark's just kind of overdoing it here. He just keeps on going, overdoing it. Well, wait till we get to the next section. In the next section, you heard the Gospel of John. We went to the whole Gospel of John. And it didn't become repetitive because it was always a new little cameo, wasn't it? But really, the message was very similar. It was us knowing who Jesus was so we could believe in him. And that's what John did in his organization of his gospel. Matthew did it in order to reveal the Messiahship of Jesus. Mark is doing it in order to show us how we have ministry in the midst of whatever context we find ourselves in. It should be something informing to know that he did this at the beginning of his gospel. We're in the fourth chapter, right? And there are, you know, 13 or so chapters in Mark. And this is a theme that continually repeats itself. Well, look at John. What did John say to the seven churches? He's read the seven churches of Revelation. I've had people say to me, hey, let's do Revelation. It just opens us up. I say, really? It points us back to the same thing. He says to all seven churches, the message is, you don't forget why you're here. You're here to be a witness for the gospel. Over and over and over and over, he says it. And I think, why do we need to hear this so much? Because, as that hymn said, my heart is so prone to wander. It's prone to get attracted to other things. It's prone to prioritize things. And Christianity is certain to prior. Christianity is not a priority. Christianity is the full substance of our life. Jesus Christ is everything from first to last. He's not just a way we do things. He's not a model for us. He is all to us. He doesn't just show us how to be righteous. He gives us his righteousness. He doesn't show us how to love. He gives us himself as love. And as a result, Mark is taking people who are highly distracted by something. I guess if you're going to be distracted by something, persecution is something that's worthy of being distracted by. But even here, his comforting words to them are not just, you know, love God and die. Many other parables. Jesus spoke the word to them. He spoke what? The word to them. What is the Bible about? We call it the word of God. Why do we know it's the word of God? What gives us the evidence in a very short period of time that we're hearing the word of God? One of those characteristics is that it brings us into the action to be a broadcaster of the Word of God. Amen. Broadcaster. You know, I'm going to be planting some things around my house. You want to help me? You get to dig all the holes. And you don't have to worry about where to face the tree is, which way it should face, sunshine, da-da-da. You know, you just dig the holes. You want to help us in the garden? Sure. Karen's dad used to plant about an acre garden up on his farm. It was really great. You want to help us with the garden? Sure. Well, after I take my thing down there, I'm going to pick up all the rocks. I already did that in the field, you know. Now I'm doing it in the garden. I got a high calling. Pick up the rocks. But if you don't pick up the rocks, the garden won't grow. I'm not an evangelist. Oh, really? Make sure someone who is has the things that they need. You know, one soldier in the field, and I'm not sure about the statistics on this, but I know the one soldier carrying his backpack and having his arm and his armor, you know, whatever he's doing, his gun. I'm trying to think of some fancy name for a gun. A gun. He's carrying his gun. Every single soldier has over 100 people supporting him or her. It's incredibly high. Every teacher has literally, it used to be just about 10 or 12 people. Now it's close to 60 or 70 people supporting that teacher in the classroom to the point where the whole thing has become top-heavy administratively. But in order for a soldier to be able to fight, he's got to have people supporting him. In order for a person to cast some seed, he has to have support. It may be your seed. Or maybe part, because the harvest is all of our harvest, right? We don't come together and say, well, it's the evangelist's harvest. No, it's all of our harvest. As we work together, that's how the kingdom of God works. And it says that he spoke the word to them as much as they could understand. There are lofty things in the kingdom of God. There are lofty things in our faith. All you got to do is pick up a systematic theology and read it, and you can see that within it, just in the theological structures of the scriptures, there's a lot of lofty things. I often have people that like to test me, and they like to come, and they often do a good job because they found some word that I have never heard of before. Well, it's right in this systematic theology. Okay, you go next, okay? Let me see if I can find a word you don't know. You look at a systematic theology, you know, listen, when I read commentaries, I read dictionaries or whatever. Well, not dictionaries so much because they're telling me what the word means. But I have this little system in my notation, and I put a little dot and then another little dot right next to it, two dots. And in the sentence, the word that I have no idea what it means, I put another dot by that. And then I look up that word, and then I put a little squiggly definition of that word, and I try to review what that word means. I kick myself, you know what I'm going to do? When I write stuff, I'm going to use those words. Because, man, that's impressive. I heard, you know, ad rosa. What is it? Someone said ad rosa this week. And I thought, ad rosa. What is ad rosa? It means secretly. Just say secretly. Okay. But it's an amazing thing. The complexities that are around us within, just in theology. Theology is not just some, that's following God. No, it's a very precise science. Very precise. When you're saying something, the way you say it, and how you articulate it, the precision that it needs is very important to communicate what it really is. All you got to do is talk about faith and works, and you can find yourself thinking you're on one side and you're really supporting the other side until someone comes up and points that out to you. It's precision. There's a lot of things, and a lot of things we don't understand. But as much as we can understand, it all points us to the Word of God, broadcasting the Word of God. I don't think, if I ever preach a message, you go away thinking about, well, now I know what that word means, aseity, oh my, with life, oh, with life. And you say, you impress everybody, you know, God's greatest characteristic is aseity. He has, they go, whoa, what's that? Well, don't you know that? It's a simple thing. Well, say it simply. He has life within himself. Some things are hard to hear because we don't really have the mechanism to really grasp them. Jesus, to his disciples, he gave the time to go back over a subject, even though it seemed like that should have been understood very easily. He spoke the word to them as much as they could understand. He did not say anything to them without using a parable. But when he's alone with his own disciples, he explained everything to them. I'm so convinced that discipleship is the process of helping us understand what we believe. We know we believe that Jesus died for our sins, he was buried, he rose again the third day. We know that. But just within that simple phrase, there's so much more that we can discover as we give ourselves to the personal, kind of like the quiet study of Scripture. We want to learn more about it, understand it more. And discipleship is that process. I mean, I've talked to people in just simple places and talk about what it is to be saved. Having people, I know they're saved, they know they're saved, they believe they're saved, but they don't really can't explain anything about being saved. They just know they're saved. And how refreshing it is to turn from Scripture to Scripture to Scripture and show them what this actually means. A study through Romans, the book of Romans, in a very careful way, it just awakens us. Is that how it works? Is that what God has done? And what is our usual response? Praise the Lord! And it causes a little more light, a little place is like a blank. Just open up and light comes out of that, and light broadcasts itself. Be careful, because you're sowing seed at that point. The things that are interesting to you, you're sowing seed. That's why there's so many kinds of seeds in the world. There's so many kinds of results. And there's so many means to sow the word, and it brings out this glorious response that's being spoken about here. And so we find ourselves being instructed, I hope, all of us. We find ourselves being instructed about what the kingdom of God is like. One of the things we say, and even in our vision statement, is that to advance the kingdom of God to ourselves and to another generation, to advance it, what does that mean? Well, we've discovered some of that, haven't we, in the last 5 or 6 weeks. As we see, this is how the kingdom of God advances. It's how it works. And guess what? It's not complex. There's simple things for us to grasp and participate with. And as I've done several times already, I'd like to just close this sermon today and in this section of Mark with the same text by someone who obviously grasped this, and that was the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14 through 21. It's really kind of a synopsis text for everything we've been talking about. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but live for him who died for them and was raised again. So from now on, we regard no one with a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone. The new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us the ministry of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you in Christ's behalf, be reconciled with God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might have the righteousness of God. Isn't that a beautiful completion about that whole text? We're not trying to get into the ministry. The ministry is trying to get out of us. Amen? Let it sow the seed. Lord bless you.